Hello YouTube. Before I start this video, I thought I would kind of give a minor sort of warning for people who are wearing headphones and so on and so forth. There is this recent iMovie update that I've run. It's iMovie version whatever the heck it is, whenever the update section of the iTunes store or the App Store loads here. Version 10.1.5, which I installed today. And, well, today is the 16th. So it automatically updated for me. And I'm having a slight problem, and that is that the audio equalization thing that I actually started using again has a bug. And if I scroll farther down in the project here, there's a particular clip that it just doesn't work with. As you can see, when I click the auto button, the audio levels don't change at all. And I don't know what's going on with it. I have no idea if it's got something to do with this percentage I have here, which I don't think it is, but I have no clue what's going on and why it's doing this, but I just thought I just put this little warning in there because I don't know where the audio levels are going to be at. I've tried my best to kind of make everything sound and, you know, whatever, in terms of the volume, as best as I can adjust it. If there's any error, forgive me. This update kind of screwed some things over with the audio equalization, and I think it's got something to do with the fact that this is an older project that I was starting before I updated the program, so I think it kind of borked some aspects of the audio equalization feature. So while I look into it, just forgive me with this video because I don't know where the heck stuff's going wrong with the audio equalization, because some clips it just blasts the volume and some it doesn't even work at all, so just a heads up. Anyway, back to your regularly scheduled program. It's a video outside. Wow, you never thought your local Jordan could do that. I'm just kidding. Anyway, we have here today outside in the lovely traffic, and I mean it quite literally. Oh, he just ran a stop sign. A smart ass. Anyway, what we have here today is a Packard Bell Legend 108 CD Supreme computer from 1995. This machine's not the highest end of machines from Packard Bell's lineup. In fact, it's rather low end from the day, hence the name CD, but it does have Supreme in the name, probably because it's got a lot of software features and stuff that you probably could have gotten back in the day. Some of the specs are 75 megahertz Pentium processor, which this machine does have, a 1.6 gig hard drive, which the system does indeed have, 8 megs of memory, which would have came with originally, expandable to 72 megs. And this machine actually has more than the maximum memory. As a matter of fact, these machines actually have a similar motherboard to the PB series of desktop machines, except this one's in a tower, like the multimedia series were. MPEG-1 motion video playback and video memory upgrade capabilities, Windows 95 designation, so on and so forth. It's missing some side trim, but otherwise the case is in pretty decent shape. This machine was made on the 28th of November 1995, according to this little sticker right there. And it's apparently got two sound cards in it, one with a built-in modem. So I think this one here is the original Packard Bell sound modem card, hence the modem and the sound card being in one device. And I think this was something additional for a newer OS, I don't remember which. Got a parallel port, 9-pin serial, PS2 keyboard and mouse ports, as well as VGA, and the AT power supply. Now, for those who don't know these mid-90s Packard Bell computers, will undoubtedly not know that these are AT-style machines. As a matter of fact, this power switch is literally sending line voltage into the computer if I were to have it plugged in. And no, we're not going to do this video outside because, well, traffic for one thing, and two, I've got other things I got to do. But I just figured I'd take this machine outside and give you guys a basic little overview of the exterior, because really, I don't want to focus on the exterior of this machine too much for this video. And the reason is simple. It's all on the software side of things, and I'll go into more detail here in just a minute, thanks to the magic of video editing. What we're about to do in this video is another level of stupid entirely. Now, what I mean by that is, well, I don't endorse or recommend that you repeat or perform any of the following actions you're about to see in this video, if this all makes sense to you guys. And I know it's already been listed in the video title, but today we're about to do the stupidest thing in the mankind generation. I think that's a thing. Excuse my language. But regardless,
we're going to be doing a really, really, really dumb thing. If there's enough reallys in there, please let me know. We're going to be installing Windows XP on a Pentium processor at 75 megahertz, hence the Packard Bell Legend 108 CD Supreme sitting over there, ready for its video. Now, I know what you guys are thinking. You're wasting your time doing this. You're doing I get it. I mean, I have better things I could be doing right now. But other than cooking chicken, which I'm about to start doing because I don't want to contaminate my phone case with raw chicken, because, well, I actually like my iPhone 6S, and I don't want to get salmonella poisoning, because then I would be very, very, very ill for a little while, and I'm not about to do that. My digressions aside, the reason why I'm doing this is because there's actually a few people on my YouTube channel, well, my last video I should refer to, that wanted me to do this. And, you know, there's a particular YouTuber, his username's Rogue Geek, and people wanted him to install Windows XP on his Packard Bell Legend 822 CDT. And he's always pulled that as an April Fool's joke. Well, I'm taking that seriously, and I'm installing it on not only a slower Packard Bell, but one that my friend and I have a little bit of heritage to. Yeah, well, him and his father mainly, but him and I too. Because this was the very first computer that really him and I ever looked at, other than his Acer Aspire 5733Z with a cracked display. So, all in all, it's kind of a noteworthy moment. Now, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get my friend on Skype tonight to do this video with him, because, well, I'll be blatantly honest, you know, I don't know what he's doing this afternoon. He may or may not be playing games, and I only have one cell phone, so I don't know, I might have to manage something with Skype once again, but we'll see. So, before I drone this on any longer, I will have everything set up and ready to flash in the next clip. Pardon the mess and the missing dresser drawer. I had to fix my dresser recently and I have yet to put the drawer back in. We have the good old Packard Bell all set up in here, and I wish I had better lighting for you guys, but whatever, it's my room. We'll have to try and make do, because most of the stuff you're going to see is going to be on the monitor, and I don't have a capture card device. I'd like to get one someday, but I don't know how many of them are going to be Mac compatible. So, you know, I have Windows PCs that I could use, but, you know, I don't know. Anyway, let's go ahead and turn it on. Just sent that original hard drive, 1.6 gigabytes. It's an old Maxter, I believe. I'm gonna turn the speakers on. I think I've got the sound cable plugged in to the right connector. If not, the sound will come out the monitor. I think I got it connected to the monitor, don't I? I don't think so, no. So I guess if I don't get any sound, I plugged into the wrong jack, or I plugged in the wrong speakers. But yeah, like I said, this machine is currently running Windows 98 because I don't currently have the master CD to properly restore this computer. Okay, for a moment there I thought I was going to throw a Windows protection error, and I got kind of a little bit frightened, but I wouldn't have been frightened anyway, just press the reset button. It's good old Windows 98 first edition, that's what you do. That's how you fix every issue, you just press the reset button. And in typical Danelect 1 fashion, this is the greatest wallpaper of all time. Well, that's a quote from him. I think there's other wallpapers that you could use on Windows 98 that are better, but, you know, in his case, yeah. Okay. Well, on the plus side, I figured out which sound card is not the sound card. Either that, or I plugged in the wrong sound cable. Well, before we go any farther into the video, I'm going to go ahead and troubleshoot the sound issue, and I will be right back. MIDI sounds decent. I'm just using the good old MIDI mapper here. Throw up Passport. It's not the greatest MIDI I've heard, but it's not the worst either. Sounds decent enough. Sounds like the flute's coming out the right channel only. Thank you.
It sounds like the MIDI you would get on a business-grade computer or laptop in the late 1990s, something sort of that fashion. I know this is more consumer-focused, so it probably would have a greater emphasis on the MIDI, but in this case, I think because it's routing through the other sound card, it's not nearly as good, but at least I don't have to find a driver for it in Windows 98, so I guess I'll take for what it is. Alrighty, so if you guys didn't see in the BIOS, this machine does in fact have 80 megs of RAM, and there's a little Easter egg there. Happy Easter, everybody. Well, happy late Easter at this point, considering when this is uploaded. This machine normally, as I showed, takes up to 72 megs, but I think because this is a PB600 system, it can take up to 128 megs unofficially. I don't remember for sure, but I think that's actually true. What's the last plus background used? The Windows 98 one. I suppose before we upgrade, we can go toss a plus theme on. I don't have plus actually installed, but it's not like we can't go and throw a theme on in general. And we gotta love those extremely fast PCI graphics. I forget what Cirrus Logic chipset this thing uses. I don't know if it says on the front. No, it's not. It says the video memory is upgradable, which will allow you to get probably 24-bit color at 1024x768, but I don't know if it'd be worth it on a PCI graphics subset this old, unless you can find the chips for dirt cheap, which you're probably not going to. I honestly think probably do the inside your computer theme. I really like this theme. I think it's awesome. Okay, we'll go ahead and we'll set that as well as the sound effects. Because I just want to see how well this theme will transfer over to Windows XP when we upgrade it. Except it's going to take an eternity to swap everything over because this is only a Pentium 75. I remember trying to run Windows 98 on a Pentium 75. Didn't exactly run too well, but then again, I was pushing a 640x480 screen with 24-bit color at the time, and it was a, like, honest to God, guys, when I had my Toshiba Satellite Pro 400 CET, my God, was that the best laptop display I'd ever seen. And I mean that when I say that. I mean, it was drop-dead, gorgeous, beautiful display ever made. I honestly wish I still had that machine to this day. It had, honest to goodness, the best display I'd ever seen until it broke because somebody dropped it. Not calling out who specifically, but yeah, some family friends ended up going through my stuff and it ended up falling on the floor and the display controller broke, which left the display only displaying white. Computer still worked because thankfully it wasn't dropped while it was on. It just broke something in the display and the display only showed white. So that really pissed me off because that machine had the best display I'd ever seen on a vintage computer. I mean, it looked freaking amazing. You know, while I'm at it, I'll do an auto on the display if I haven't already. Just make sure that this picture is nice and sharp. This has a decently clear VGA output. Then again, this monitor is only VGA. And I think for the sake of this video, we'll probably drop the resolution. Actually, no, we'll leave it at 800x600 because the Windows XP installer hates it when I go 640x480. You know, actually, on second thought, I should probably be smart. And I should probably go 1024x768 because Windows XP prefers that. But the only unfortunate thing is that I have to drop it down to 256 colors, which I think we can do without needing to restart. I better hope this doesn't crash. If any of you guys know what I'm talking about, then okay, we're good to go. I got lucky there, everybody. All right, I want to stretch this wallpaper, even though it's not going to look great. In fact, it really doesn't look all that great, because you can see all the dithering, but this is to make sure that the all the stuff works and leaves all the high color icons, so that way Windows XP doesn't pick about it being in 256 color mode. Hopefully not too much. I better hope not. Okay, the only unfortunate thing now that I gotta do while I'm waiting to, well, while I, you know, prepare this thing for Windows XP installation, I need to go make the disk. Using the world's most reflective display ever, we are going to go ahead and checkmark that. And I think we can right click and open with.
I swear I think I have power ISO on this computer somewhere. I think I do. It should be on here. I don't know. Yes, I have run the Windows 10 Creators update on this machine, like I said. So I guess I have power ISO on this machine. I probably did. I guess it's on something else. Alright. Oops, I didn't mean to mount it, but yeah, fair enough.
I'd like to burn a disk image. This machine's not exactly a speed demon. That or it just decided to be stupid. I don't know what it's doing. It just froze the Explorer up, so that's always great. Oh my God, what did you just do, Windows? Come on. You are ridiculous. Why do you need smart screen to run your damn disk burning utility? That's... Really? Wow. Okay, that's another reason why I don't use Windows 10. Oh my god. Wow, that was stupid. Okay. So, go ahead and burn. And I'm going to stay off the bed so that way this doesn't move around and screw up the disk burning, because this is burning at 24 speed. Which I believe is also the speed of the optical drive. Actually, what is the speed of the optical drive? Yeah, it's an 8 speed. Well, a 24 speed disk can read in an 8 speed drive, so I think we'll be okay. So, yeah, I'm going to try and reduce vibrations on the bed. Let this disk burn, because this is one hell of a loud optical drive, and it's a laptop that is very screen heavy, so if I ever do anything, this thing rocks. So I need to let it sit, burn the disk, and I'll be right back. This is the worst idea I've ever had. Play Half-Life on an original Pentium 75. Although before we do, I'm going to be Samert, or in this case, if you want to be really technical about it, I'm going to be Smrat. Let's turn the resolution down. It's probably going to cause a blue screen, just watch. Oh my god, it actually didn't. You know, those people who say that Windows 98 is the worst for changing screen resolutions and color depth at the same time, I've never had an issue with it. Doesn't matter what version of Windows 98. I've never had an issue with a blue screen after a reboot or anything like that when picking display settings. Never had that issue. Let's play the world's laggiest version of Half-Life in software mode. Because DirectX 6, DirectX 6, probably isn't going to turn out too well on this machine. And as a matter of fact, I should probably turn the volume down. As you can tell, it cannot keep up with motion video playback until the very, very end. And then, you can barely play the Valve intro. Actually, that didn't do too badly there, because considering the Valve intro is very lightweight. Alrighty, everybody. Let's play the laggiest version of Half-Life. Let's see what display settings it's running at first thing. Oh my god. Are you serious? It's that slow? We're going to play this game at 320 by 240 resolution. Alright, Alt-C. Alt-D. Alt-D. Alt-N. Alt-E. Alrighty, let's play the laggiest version of Half-Life ever made. I'm surprised the monitor actually does as well as it does at resolution selection. It actually does 320 by 240 just fine. So this is a pretty versatile monitor, actually. It's probably going to say I'm running at 640 by 480 if I go into the menu here. Yeah, it says I'm running at 640 by 480, so it just downsamples the 640 by 480 resolution. But no, this monitor is pretty versatile at all the resolutions it can actually display. And here we go. Let's do this. Oh my god. We're getting a whole 3 FPS right now. Don't forget, these are some advanced graphics. There's the movement of the mouse. Which the audio is in stereo, it has to actually swap channels. Let's try walking. Oh my god. How's that 3 FPS working out for your game? Okay, that's pretty slow. Alrighty. Let's go and put the Packard bell out of its misery with playing Half-Life. And probably after that, we'll give it a restart. That way all the memory's all cleared. There it goes. For a moment there, I thought it wasn't going to restart. And no, this machine doesn't have the fancy seek test like Danawakt 1. Sorry about that, guys. Alright, guys. It's the time you have been waiting for. It is now time for... Oh my god, guys! The coffee worked!
Wow!
It actually got Windows XP to come on up! Wow! You know, this must go down in the legends of coffee solves every first world problem. First world problem. Should get some better grammar. And you know what the solution to that is? Okay, enough of the jokes aside about coffee. Let's actually get to the video that we've all been waiting for, and I mean everybody, probably. And I'm gonna be Smrat. I'm gonna change my resolution to 800 by 600 once again, since I was dinking around with Half-Life. It'd be a pretty good idea to do this. I pressed yes, thank you. It must be, again, I haven't had my coffee yet. I'm kind of in a mood. Yeah. It's better than going out and taking care of children, which my mom wanted me to do. Yeah, I'm not in the mood for that. Trust me. Alrighty, let's get the show on the road. Install Windows XP. This is probably not going to go very quickly. This is only an 8-speed CD-ROM drive, like I said, so we might be here a little while. But so far, so good. It looks as if it is running the setup process just fine. Obviously, since this is just 16-bit color, there's a little bit of dithering. That's very noticeable, but it still looks pretty good. I could swap this to 24-bit color, but I didn't feel like I needed to, so it'll work just fine. Okay, so just out of curiosity's sake, we are going to do an upgrade. Because I'm an idiot, and idiots upgrade their computers. And I'll be right back once I put in my product key. I don't suppose it really matters too much anyways. This is a volume license copy of Windows. As you notice, volume license product key. So, I'll be right back. Custom programs or devices might not work with Windows XP. Setup will create a report of known issues for your computer. The report is automatically saved and can be viewed after the upgrade. If there are problems after the upgrade, you can uninstall Windows XP and return to your current version of Windows. And show me hardware issues and a limited set of software issues. Why the heck not? Let's see what's up with this machine. Probably going to be because lack of USB ports. That's probably what's going to trigger this thing. So... I needed to grab a lightning cable. I need to start importing files onto my computer. So I will let this do its thing and I'll be right back.
When you have a small house and you gotta use a box fan, well, that's what you gotta do. When you have Packard Bell running especially.
Setup can save your existing Windows system files so you can uninstall Windows XP and return to your previous version of Windows. Requires 91 megabytes of additional disk space. Sure, why not? We'll do that. We'll save it on to drive D. That works. I have two hard drives in this computer, so it'd probably be best if it actually stores them there. Oh, yeah, no disk space. Save as on the desktop. Great. We'll view those in Internet Explorer, see what's going on. Computer does not have enough disk space to install Windows XP. You need at least 1,034 megabytes. Gotcha. Well, we can go clear up some disk space. That's one thing that we're gonna have to look into. Apparently. Okay, so exit. Let's go to, once the thing cooperates here, let's go to my computer and I'll go see what we can do. I see what it means by we need disk space. This is only a 1.6 gig hard drive, so it should be relatively easy to clear up a little bit of space. I know exactly what I can uninstall, actually. We just go into control panel and we just start uninstalling some stuff. I think that'll be the magic trick. We go under add remove programs. The biggest thing is going to be taking out Half-Life, because that was a joke of me to install that. That takes up about 400 megabytes of space. Yep, I get that. And this might take a little bit. Alright. So, that window should come back up any second now. We're going to uninstall the Sierra utilities as well. Let's see. That's not come back up yet. I guess I got to do it myself. Okay, we're going to leave the DirectX drivers there. We're going to uninstall the Sierra utilities. Because DirectX could be useful. I know Windows XP will fix that. Computer needs to be rebooted to finish. Well, let's clear out some of these windows so that way when it does reboot, it won't open everything up at a time.
and go ahead. I went ahead and turned off the speaker because I went to my grandmother's house so I could enjoy some Easter brunch. So it's pretty good. Had some biscuits and gravy, had some fresh strawberries, and got some chocolate milk, some orange juice, actual chocolate with coconut filled in it. You know, it's pretty good. Oh, I should probably take out the Windows XP CD before I try to boot up off it, because if I try to have it boot off the Windows XP CD, the BIOS locks up. It doesn't like that. Okay, let this reboot. I'm gonna go grab some more coffee, deal with Psycho Cat, which is literally right there.
After the reboot, we're actually doing pretty good now. We have enough disk space that we can do an upgrade on Windows XP. Sweet. So, we're gonna go ahead and go forth with the upgrade once the auto run decides it wants to function and not freeze the Windows Explorer. I said Alta 4.
Oh boy. And it's good to turn the box fan off. Oh boy. I think I froze the Windows Explorer. Yeah. Control Alt Delete didn't work so well, now did it? Oh, there it is. Okay, never mind. Press Escape. Okay, just took a while. Okay, we're going to install Windows XP, and now I should not have to worry about anything. I'm not going to create the report because now I know what I was worried about, and that was disk space. So I'm going to just do a straight upgrade now without making a report because I know what it is now, and I fixed it all up.
Okay, so I'm a little confused. It hasn't come up with a dialogue asking me if I wanted to keep my installation files this time around to uninstall Windows XP. It looks as if it's just copying the files off of the CD and just giving it. I don't know if that's a good idea or not. I don't know if it's actually continuing with it or not. I don't know. I hope it gives me the dialogue. I mean, not that I have anything against uninstalling Windows XP and going back to 98, but oh yeah, it's going through with the upgrade, that's for sure. Okay. Well, I guess I'll let it manually do its thing. But yeah, like I was talking about or was going to talk about, I can always reinstall XP 98 again off the CD if I need to desperately reinstall Windows 98. I'm really looking to actually get a Packard Bell Master CD for a machine like this and the boot floppy and properly restore this computer back to factory Windows 95 state, which would be nice. I don't know if I'm ever gonna find a disk image of like a purple or an orange or a black Master CD. I think the Black Master CDs were only ever seen on the Platinum Packard Bells or something similar to that. Alrighty, it just rebooted. The one annoying thing about this process, and I don't know if it's even going to work, let's find out here. Starting Windows Setup, oh here's a rare screen that you guys will probably never see, where it boots up the Windows pre-installation environment. This is a pretty rare event, because it boots up like Windows 2000, which on a Pentium 75 takes an eternity. And it'll literally say just Microsoft Windows. There's no XP on it, there's no pre-installation environment thing, it just says Microsoft Windows and the progress bar is gray. Kind of a hint to, I guess, Windows Server, or just the fact that you're just booting a bland XP thing, I have no clue. But this is something I don't see very often because I don't do a heck of a lot of these things because I don't like to do Windows upgrades, I usually do clean installations, but I still think that this screen right here is kind of unique, that they didn't really complete it any farther than they actually ended up doing. I hope it works. I sure hope it does. Be hilarious if it actually does work. Of course, knowing my luck, it probably won't work. It's just a Pentium 75 after all. Oh my god, are you serious? It is giving its level best to work right now. Unbelievable. Wow, okay. That's impressive. Wow, okay.
Enough of the wows, we're not Windows Vista here. Anyway, yeah, okay, it's working. Sweet. Cool. Windows will not only start faster than any previous version, but it also runs your programs more quickly and reliably than ever. Windows NT file system. Okay, guys, so I'll be back, and I'm going to let this upgrade. Kind of ironic that the S up here in Microsoft is actually a dollar sign. Isn't that any more true than it is? Holy crap, that took like 40 minutes, and it's finally on its first restart. Well, I should say second, because that was the first restart when I got out of Windows 98 and started running the setup. I should probably eject the CD before it tries to boot up off of it. And I already committed the fate of the BIOS. Oh my goodness, yeah, if I Control-Alt-Delete, it doesn't do anything. I have to press reset. Rather annoying. and reopen the disk drive. And wait for the memory check once again. I hate when that does that. You gotta wait, and eventually it'll come on, and oh my goodness, it's a good length of wait. It's gotta check all 80 megs. Yeah. And then, everybody loves this sound. Oh, it didn't do the floppy seat this time. I see how it is. Okay, Windows XP Professional setup starting now. There's that long progress bar. Alrighty, let's see that beautiful Windows XP logo we all are, you know, familiar with. There it goes. I cannot believe this is actually working. Like, you do not understand how surprised I actually am. And of course, it's going to go into another pre-installation environment, and it's going to finish all the setup up in that. And I believe we are actually going to have support for high color mode in 640 by 480. I don't know if that'll be the case, but I hope we do. Nope, it's running in 256 colors. Well, at least we have a graphical portion of the setup that we can actually use to our advantage, you know. You don't often get that sort of thing. I'll do an auto here on the monitor real quick. You can tell it's in 256 colors because the mouse cursor looks rather old and dated. There's no drop shadow on it. Look at that. Listen to that hard drive go. Yeah, it's being taxed, but you should see the menu come up any second now. It's not going to look pretty, but it'll certainly be functional. Setup will complete in approximately 41 minutes. Of course, that's the typical amount of time they throw on an upgrade, although it's certainly not dynamic. I don't think it's actually going to take 41 minutes, although I'm going to start a stopwatch and we will find out. We will do that right now. I have this random thingy here that I can use that apparently started charging again. And we can go ahead and open up this and I'm going to start a stopwatch here. Okay. Well, while I'm waiting for Windows XP to install in the Packard Bell, I'm getting some other videos made in the meantime, just so that way I can have more stuff to get to work with, and that way I don't have to record nearly as much, although that's probably going to hurt me in the long run. We'll see. But anyway, let's check up on the Packard Bell. It says it has approximately 37 minutes left, and it initially said it would complete in approximately 41 minutes when it started. However, it's been an enormous 21 minutes and 15 seconds, so I don't think we're making very much progress. What do you guys think? Yeah, this thing is pretty darn slow, and I don't think we're going to make very much progress in a timely fashion. The one interesting thing that I will point out, though, that I think is rather interesting is the pattern on the dithering is actually an XOXO pattern. And then again, I got to remark that the S is a dollar sign. So Microsoft really is made with money. So, yeah. This is my dedication for you all and my video-making patience. It has almost been an hour and a half, and it still says it's got 21 minutes left, and it's still going! Unbelievable. You know, guys, this is my dedication for you all, so I just want you guys to keep that in mind. I waste my time doing this for you all. I don't know what I'm doing anymore. It's still effing going. I cannot believe that. Holy crap, it's still flipping going. Unbelievable. It's 2.5 hours in on this one section with no reboots, and it's still going. How much longer do we have? Another hour? Oh my goodness. That's just crazy. Okay, I think we're almost there. Pretty much 2 hours and oh my goodness. Unbelievable. The next major update to the award-winning Internet Explorer technologies. Internet Explorer 6 includes many new and enhanced features that help maintain the privacy of information sent and received over the web while simplifying the daily tasks that you perform. Like not being able to go to Google in 2017. Oh, man. But really. This is why I recommend you do not do this to your own machine. Because this is time-consuming. And I mean, you go out, and you go take a trip to the Tri-Cities and whatnot and come back, and this thing will still not be done. And that's an inside joke in and of itself. I mean, unbelievable. I mean, literally, you could start an upgrade on this machine, drive to the Tri-Cities, come back, and this thing would probably not be done. That's how slow this thing is, so. Oh my goodness. I think it's idling the CD-ROM drive, but I'm not gonna take it out just quite yet. but my goodness, it's taking forever. But I think it's going to restart here very shortly, so yeah. Okay, it's finally restarting at 2 hours, 37 minutes, and 45 seconds. Wow. That's just crazy. That's a new record. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Well, I gotta turn the light on and I'll be right back. Since I don't need this anymore, it can just go right there. I might just give this thing a break since it's been on for so long, but no, I'm just half tempted to just let it, you know, just finish up. I'm just half tempted to let it finish up its installation. Because it's gone so well so far. Let's let it finish. Get the pain and horror out of the way. You know, it makes me wonder, is it actually still in FAT32? Or is it going to convert itself to NTFS? That's going to be interesting. I think it might be because the system's so old that it may or may not actually be able to convert to NTFS. But considering when this machine was new, all things considered, it probably could have ran Windows NT Workstation 4.0. Not very well, but it would have been able to run it, so I don't know. But, yeah, looks like it's making an effort to work, so that's pretty cool, actually. I mean, that is pretty unbelievable. So, yeah, let's see what happens here. Oh my goodness. It's actually having to draw the screen. Wow, unbelievable. But it did have the display driver, which is rather impressive, and it's trying to play the sound. Very slowly. That's hilarious. It is trying its level best to use the out-of-box experience, and it just can't do it. Come on, baby. Let's do this. Turn that down. Oh my goodness. Well, I don't know whether or not this has broken the level of patience yet, or what the deal might possibly be. This is just crazy. Come on, Packard Bell, you got this. It's loading something. Very, 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 very. Oh my goodness, it's finally loading it. Wow. Is he gonna try and do the whole loading thingy? Oh my god, this is so slow. It's actually got the display driver with high color set at 800 by 600. Oh, this mouse sucks on this surface. I took away the Doom mouse pad thingy. Let's try and press next. Oh.
Oh my goodness. Come on, computer. Oh my god. Oh my god, come on.
Oh, it's trying to load the animation. Yeah, it is certainly trying to load that animation up. But it just can't do it very fast. Well, I guess I'll record some more if I find anything else interesting. I'm just gonna let this thing sit and load the next page. It's taking forever. But it is trying its level best to play the background music, at least, which is hilarious. Alright, I'm gonna go and turn the camera off now. Okay, I've been away for about a couple minutes and it still hasn't registered that I've clicked next. Should I be worried? It is still trying to play the music. It is just trying its level best to do it, but it just can't do it all at the same time. Oh my god, this is painful to watch, but at the same time it's very entertaining and educational. Alt-N. I can still move the mouse, so at least I have that going for me, but yeah, I'm gonna let this sit, I think. Turn the speakers off, and I'm just gonna let this sit. Turn the monitor off as well so I save some power. I'm just gonna let this sit. Well, that suffers through its misery, which I think I can't really tell. I think it's finally recognized I've pressed next. Can't really tell. I have a little bit of a curious question.
because I need expanded graphics in this machine for future gaming purposes, should I throw in this GeForce 9800 GT? It does need PCI Express power, but I believe I can just supply an adapter that takes 6-pin down to 2 4-pin Molexes, and I can just supply my graphics card power that way. And I think, if I position this carefully, because I don't want to, you know, put it in just quite yet, it looks as if I shove some cables out of the way, it would fit in the case just fine. So, what do you guys think? Should I throw in this 9800 GT? Make a good graphics card under Windows XP. Stop the press, stop the press. It's pressed next. The animation's running. I think the music stopped playing. Yeah, the music stopped playing. So it's all caught up now, and it's actually finished the animation. It's recognized I've clicked next. We are progressing through this setup process right now. We are on the roll. About 5 minutes later, after clicking next, we are finally making it up in the... Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness, it is trying. It is trying. I think now I'm going to have to wait for the question mark animation to finish before we can even continue. I don't know. I might be stuck doing that. Yeah, I'm thinking that's what's going to end up happening, probably. Yeah, it has successfully done the animation. The animation's done. Now we just got to wait for the computer to catch up. Now that there's no background music to hold us down. Yep, finally. Oh my god. Hey, anybody ever seen this outline before? That's hilarious. Who will use this machine? I don't know. Can't possibly be me. Oh my goodness, this is taking forever. And should have the finished screen. Yep, there we go. And that's actually recognizing when I click finish. Now my guess is obviously it's still in FAT32, which, hey, that's more than good enough for me. I'm just looking forward to seeing that desktop. Really, I am. It has been long in the making. So I better see that desktop here within like 5-10 minutes. Or maybe I'll end up seeing a blue screen, we'll see. Apparently it has such little memory that it just decided not to use the welcome screen, and I need to set a password for the administrator account. So, yeah. I'll set one here real quick. Alright. Yeah, the welcome screen's probably been disabled, but I've installed XP on 64 megs of memory, and I didn't have the welcome screen get disabled, so maybe it's because of all the technology that I have. I'm not entirely sure. Okay, I think on Windows 98 there's only one account by the administrator, so I want to say that that's what I'm going to have to log in as. So I'll let it do its thing, I guess. We'll see how laggy the startup sound is. Yeah, there it goes. Transferred the theme over. Okay, that worked. Cool. We are in 16-bit color. I can definitely tell dithering's going on in that gradient there. Or maybe it's in 24-bit color. I'm not entirely sure. I guess I'll find out whenever this finally gets to the desktop, because, yeah, it's been a heck of a long time in the making. Man, am I excited to see this. Wow. Don't worry. Wow. It played the login sound just fine. Maybe because it wasn't loaded down, I guess. I thought it was going to, like, stutter 50 million times before it finished. But no, it actually played the sound just fine. That's really impressive. That is really impressive. The more that I see what this machine can do, the more it really impresses me. And the cool thing is, it actually has a shadow now underneath the mouse cursor. Which, by the way, is working just fine, mind you. So, wow. Alrighty. Well, I'm going to let the desktop load. So I walked back in after about a couple minutes, and cursor changed back to default. What could it be doing? I have no idea. Then again, we were upgrading from Windows 98 First Edition to Windows XP, which is basically the minimum supported OS that you can upgrade from. So, yeah, we're still waiting. No desktop yet. And surprisingly, not a lot of heat came out of the back. So that's kind of nice. I guess let's see if I can open up the control delete menu. Can I do that? Yeah, I don't know. I guess I'll see what happens. It's probably the CPU's under 100% load. It's probably what's going on right now. Hey, PB108 CD Supreme. Well, that's kind of neat. It's got the name of the computer there. Let's open up Task Manager and see where we're at here with all the progress that's going on right now, which is probably not a whole lot.
No, surprisingly, Task Manager did open. But yeah, it's getting taxed pretty good. 100% pretty much all the time. In terms of the 80 megs of memory though, we're doing pretty good on the memory front. We're not using that much page file. We're actually keeping pretty much everything in memory. But yeah, I'm leave this open. It's interesting that the EXE portion of Explorer is intercapitalized compared to the rest. Now that's interesting. But yeah, I'm gonna let this sit and let it finish up setup, and maybe we might just see a desktop tonight. CSRSS.exe is using quite a bit of, REGSVR32 is also using up a lot of CPU as well. But we are almost there, ladies and gentlemen. We're almost there. It made it. Wow, that took forever. But it worked. I actually have Windows XP running right now on this computer. This is pretty freaking awesome. I can't even believe it made it myself. I mean, really. So now let's do the obligatory look at my computer and move Task Manager. Oh my goodness, my Easter egg's still there. That's funny. Yep, Intel Pentium processor, 75 megahertz, 80 megs of RAM. Holy crap, I never thought that this would see the light of day, but it has, and that's pretty awesome. Wow. That's just amazing. And this text here on the start menu is quite off. It has a orange tint to it, which is weird, but it's working. I mean, I can probably go in and very slowly open up programs. Let's open up calculator just as a basic sample program test. And there's calculator, and it's even got live window preview, which is, I didn't think it would actually have that sort of capability. It didn't earlier, but I guess it has the capability of it. Now, one thing I'm gonna go do, because I can, and this would be a very smart thing to do, is I'm going to go change the theme to a more sensible theme for XP, if I can, because this might take a while. Oh, this is pretty dreadfully slow, but it is working somehow. I think that's the default theme with that background, which is hilarious. Oh my goodness. Mystery wallpaper, nature wallpaper, all the wallpapers, you know? We're gonna set Bliss as the wallpaper of choice today. And what kind of stuff do we have on the display side? Only two resolutions. And I can't even swap up to 1024x768. I am stuck at this resolution color depth, so. Yay, if you like your 16-bit color, you ought to be pretty committed to this. And I'm not changing any of the appearance settings because I actually want it to be, you know, I want the maximum amount of performance out of this while keeping the Luna theme. And so far, it is being very competent. It is by no means usable, but oh my goodness. It is actually making some kind of an effort to work, which is very impressive. You know what I should probably do is I should actually mark the startup time and see how long it actually takes to start up. That ought to be a kind of a curious test. Man, those PCI graphics, you know. But out of curiosity, I'm just going to go check the performance and maintenance section here real quickly and just to see if maybe I can turn down some of the animation settings and stuff. See, there's the adjust visual effects button. We're going to go click on that and let's just do that real quick. What's best for my computer? Wow, there's quite a bit, actually. Common tasks and folders. Shows shadows under the mouse pointer. I don't really need that. Animate windows. No, we don't really need that either. Show window contents while dragging. I'll leave that on because that's actually pretty impressive. Slide open combo boxes. Yeah, sure. Smooth scroll list boxes. Use common tasks and folders. Use visual styles. That would be the Luna theme, so I want to leave that on. So, yeah. Oh my goodness, I better let this do its thing. After all that, we have 419 megs of free space. I say we did pretty good. That's why we have a secondary hard drive. Oh my goodness. Well, I guess that ends this extravaganza. I don't know what I'm going to do with this installation of Windows. I guess I'll try playing something in Windows Media Player, but I am definitely for sure going to be turning off the visualization because there's no way in hell it's going to be able to do that alongside playing a MP3. I mean, heck, this thing is probably too slow to play an MP3 to begin with, so yeah. But let's see what it can do. Might actually be able to play something. It does have sound after all, so maybe it can, maybe it can. But no, definitely at a minimum, I'd probably do, I don't know, 100 megahertz Pentium. Maybe 133, or 166, or maybe a goofy 120 if they actually work in a system like this. I don't know what the fastest Pentium would be for a system like this, I'm not sure. All I know is it is taking a while to open that media up. I like that animation, that's kind of neato. But before it loads, we're going to hopefully turn visualization off. I don't know how you do that on this. It's trying. Oh my goodness. You know, I thought about curiosity. Just curiosity. I actually thought about wanting to put some video in MPEG 1. Oh my goodness, it is now lagging the mouse cursor like crazy. That was a bad idea. But even bigger idea that's worse is encoding video in MPEG 1 and trying to edit in Windows Movie Maker on this computer. I don't think that would work out very well. I'm not going to do it. No, I'm not going to do it. Because I'm not going to waste a C over it. Yeah, that was a mistake. Oh my goodness, can I even get Task Manager open to end this? I better hope I can. Oh my god. Let's end the disgrace. Well, I turned the visualization off, but I'm not having any more luck than I am right now trying to play this. I guess this is a WAV file. It really is putting in a good effort. I wonder if I were to pause this, because it's much more responsive now that I've taken out the visualization. I wonder, where's the title bar? There it is. Gotta wait for it to render in, it takes a while. I wonder if we can play a MIDI file. I wonder if it's still got the old MIDI files from Windows 98 still on the drive, or if it's been replaced by all the Windows XP stuff. That makes me wonder.
So let's go into my computer. And let's go into boot. Apparently there's still Sierra folder in there from when I installed Half-Life. Let's go into Windows.
Yes, indeed it did. Let's try and play Canyon. This is probably going to fail badly. It's probably going to fail very badly. But you know what? I've got to try. I've got to try it. Oh, screwed the MIDI up. Let's see if these work. Yeah. They do work. But, wow, this mouse is weird. Let's take this opportunity to turn the volume up here. Task Manager is like saying the CPU is like every which way, but oh, I closed it, that's right. Well, let's go see what's going on. This is probably gonna be the worst idea ever, but let's go check what's going on here with the sound and why the MIDI's not working. I wonder if it's been just turned back off to the default Windows one. That could possibly be.
I mean, it's really not unresponsive. It's certainly responsive enough to use. So, I guess it works. I don't know. All right, sound, speech, and audio devices. Another flashlight. Yeah, this will certainly increase the compatibility of this computer if you can even stand using a thing like this. It'll be hilarious if you can try to use this thing. Maybe one of these days, if I ever get curious enough, I'll toss a network card in this thing and see if I can even go online on Pentium 75 running Windows XP with probably Firefox 12, because I don't want to take this thing past Service Pack 1, because it's really not worth waiting and all the performance penalties that I get with Service Pack 2, even though it probably let me use newer web browsers, like, I don't know, newer versions of Firefox, who knows.
Okay, so we need to go under audio. And MIDI playback. Yes, it did change the synthesizer, so we need to change it to Crystal FM synthesizer. And we'll press apply. And let that apply. And while it's doing that, I'm going to close the control panel. Now we freeze up some RAM. Alright. Then we go ahead and press stop on Windows Media Player. And we try it again. Oh, that's a lot better. Now it's not using the CPU to play the MIDI. Now we actually have working MIDI. Oh my goodness. I do not recognize how much of a godsend this would actually be. But it's actually playing MIDI now, and I don't have to worry about the CPU overhang. Let's try another MIDI file. I did try, what the heck was it? Passport at the beginning. Let's give the passport a go.
all the instruments are screwed up. Well, maybe they're not. I'm just blind, I guess. I don't know. The one thing I'm curious to try is going to be One Stop, because that's the one that comes with XP and 2000 for that matter. No, it came with Windows Millennium Edition, sorry. 2000 was the last one with the passport and the canyon, but ME was the first one to introduce the One Stop and other stuff and take out all the other MIDIs.
I forgot about that. Let's see if we can play One Stop and make it sound interesting.
Ooh. That sounds pretty cool, actually. Because usually this MIDI just is rendered by software. When you actually hear it with MIDI hardware, that's actually kind of unique. What's... That MIDI volume's turned up a little too much. That sounds pretty cool, actually. But, you know, I actually have another sound card. It's an ISA sound card. It's a Sound Blaster AWE64 Gold, and it does work under XP. I wonder if it would actually make use of the MIDI capabilities. You know, obviously the system isn't much more useful than what it is right now, and I could probably find some more 72-pin SIMs outside to throw in the system, but as of right now, it is doing its job. Let's go ahead and close this panel out. Now that I got hardware MIDI working. Oh, that was a mistake. It is still kind of CPU dependent, though. Sounds cool, though. I gotta get some other MIDIs to throw on this thing, make it floppy, and see how they sound. Well, I think that's it for now. I'm going to go ahead and turn this thing off. It's been on for quite a while, and I'm going to give it a break just because I'm not really enjoying leaving this thing on for extended periods of time, just because not exactly good for all the hardware. Interesting, it's left view channels in the taskbar for some reason. It's throwing this HTML file in the quick run for some reason. I don't know why. Don't know why I need that in the taskbar, and I don't know why I need this in the taskbar either. Launch Outlook Express, Launch Internet Explorer, and they're completely incorrect icons, so, yeah. Alrighty, let's go ahead and shut this down. And now I'm kind of curious, I want to see if, when I go to shut it down, do I get the screen of, is it safe to turn off your computer? Because this is an AT computer, by the way, that we're running XP on right now. So, because it's an AT system, what do we get? Well, you can hear that hard drive crunching away a lot. It actually plays the sound smoothly, which for the logon, which is kind of interesting. But there we have it. Windows XP on a Pentium 75. Somehow. I cannot believe that actually worked today. So I guess before I format it back to Windows 95 or 98, one of the two, I guess we'll see if there's anything you guys want me to do with this system. Just kind of experiment with it. And no, I'm not doing Half-Life on it, but I will experiment with Doom if you guys want me to. Maybe. If I have enough time, of course. Ah, that's a lot more classy than you'd think it would be. It's now safe to turn off your computer, because this is an AT-style computer, by the way. And off she goes. Okay, so to end this video epic, we're just going to do one last startup on video. Just because I kind of want to see how fast this thing starts up. And I have plenty of time to prepare myself, considering the memory test takes forever on this machine. And, after the double beep, I gotta itch my nose. I'll probably minus off a second. Let's just see how long this thing takes to start up. That's just smudges on the screen. I thought there was something wrong with the display itself. I'm gonna try and make this display look less smeary. That'd be pretty good. And wait for the theme to come on. Should be on very shortly. I don't think it really matters too much. So, yep, there it goes. Minute and 56 seconds to make it to a fully functional logon prompt. Or, if you want to be specific, 1 minute 55.91 seconds. And now, give it a little bit of a breathing chance here. Let's count the seconds it takes to log on. Turn the speakers a little bit so we can hear the logon sound, just because it actually plays smoothly on this machine. And there's only three icons that should load at the bottom, which should be volume, the .NET, and the tour. Okay, there's the tour. Now the start menu felt like opening. Don't know why.
And the start menu should be done. Close the start menu here.
And we're done. About a minute 23 seconds, somewhere in there. Alrighty. That concludes this video. So, with that having been said, I don't think I'd ever do a thing like this again, just because it takes way too long. And I have other things to do besides wait for a computer like this, but I figured that this would be a unique opportunity because why the heck not? So until next time, well, I don't think there's much else to say other than see you guys later. Well, see you guys later.